Hi, James Whiffen here for PluginEverything.com, and today we're going to look at how to create an After Effects plugin. First thing you want to do is type in After Effects SDK into Google and you'll get this page. Then click Get the SDKs and that will give you a download that looks something like this. Got the manual and then some examples in here. We want under Template Skeleton. And I'd recommend open Visual Studio in administrator mode, because otherwise you probably won't be able to build the plugin. And if you're on Mac, you won't have Visual Studio, you'll have Xcode. So on Windows, we want to open the skeleton.solution. And then once that's loaded, let's go to skeleton.cpp. And we're interested firstly in the render function. This is a skeleton template project. It actually does something. It's not very exciting. It just fills the screen with a solid color. So we're going to delete all this stuff here. And we're also going to delete the helper functions, my simple gain func. Cool. So now this is clean. If we ran this, the plugin wouldn't do anything at all. It would just be blank. What we want to do is draw a straight line. And for that, we're going to use an algorithm called Bresenham's line algorithm. I just typed in Bresenham's line algorithm and found this website, the crazy programmer. He's pretty crazy. He's got an algorithm here that I'm going to pinch. This is the function that draws a line. And we're going to place it outside the render function. And you'll see it has a reference to a function called putPixel, which essentially it takes an X and Y coordinate and then draws that pixel a certain color. The way we're going to color pixels is first we need access to those pixels. Have a look in the SDK and we open up the SDK guide. On page 140, there is a function that does that for us. So I'm just going to copy that. We want the sample integral 32, not the 64, because the 32-bit one, that's going to allow us to work with 8 bits per channel. It says 32 because there's red, green, blue, and 4 times 8 is 32. What this function does is it returns a pixel. It's actually a pointer to a pixel. What we need to supply it is an effect world and an X and Y coordinate. An effect world is kind of like a frame buffer or a texture. It's the image that we want, or the canvas rather, that we want to draw to. Instead of saying put pixel X and Y, we're going to say we want to have a pixel, PF pixel, and we're going to call it my pixel. And then we want to say that this pixel is equal to sample integral 32. Then we will provide it with a frame buffer, we'll call it the output, and then an X and Y coordinate, so we'll just supply the X and Y coordinate. Now we currently don't have access to the output, so what we'll do is just put that in here. We'll add in a PF effect world, and we're going to make it a pointer, and we're going to call this the output. And this should actually be a pointer, not an actual pixel, and then we should supply that as a pointer as well. Now that we have a pointer to the pixel that we wanted to sample, we can color it. We might go my pixel red equals 255, which is the brightest value that an 8 bits per channel pixel can have. And we might also want that to be on the alpha. So I'll say my pixel red equals my pixel alpha, which equals 255. That will fill the pixel with red. If we filled it with red, but the alpha was 0, then the pixel would be blank because it would be red, a red pixel, but it would be transparent. So we don't want that. And then we're just going to copy this function to here as well. Now we have our draw line function. We actually need to call it. So let's call it in here, draw line, and then we need to supply an X and Y coordinate, an X and Y coordinate again, and then the output. So let's just supply it X, Y, X1, Y1, and output. Now we don't have those coordinates yet, so we'll create those X, Y, X1, Y1. And a long, if you just go into it, is just the After Effects way to refer to an integer. Now we might want to initialize these, so X can be 0, Y can also be 0, and then, so these are the start coordinates, and then X1 and Y1 can be the end coordinates. So I'm going to make that the width of the entire canvas. That X and Y are going to be on the bottom right of the output. If our start X and Y are up at the top left of the screen and our X1 and Y1 are at the bottom right of the screen, it's going to draw a line from the top left of the screen to the bottom right of the screen. So now we're ready to test out our plugin. We want to be in debug mode and then we want to select skeleton, hit Alt Enter, and we want to make sure that our output directory is building it to where we want it to be. So I've got a macro that points to After Effects CC 2018, and then under debugging, we want the command to be After Effects. So if we hit edit, we can actually use After Effects. So I'm going to use AECC 2018, which is the macro that I have that points to After Effects, and hit apply on that. Now let's press local Windows debugger. That's going to build and run After Effects. What we want to do in After Effects is just pretty much build a blank solid, and then our plugin's going to be called Skeleton, and it looks good. If we chose to 16 bits per channel, it's not really going to work because we're only working at 8 bits per channel, but in 8 bits per channel, it does work nicely. If we wanted it to work at other bit depths, we'd have to do some more work, and I don't really want to do that. But this is a pretty boring line because it's always locked to the top left and the bottom right. Let's build a user interface so that we can actually control where this line is. Go back into Visual Studio and stop that. Let's go under Skeleton to Params Setup. And here we currently have two parameters. I'm going to get rid of the first one. Now we want to find the macro PF add point because we want to add a start and end point for our line. And this is a macro here and it takes the arguments name, X default, Y default, restrict bounds, and an ID. The name is a string, we'll call this start. And then we want an X default, which is percentage based. So we want the left to be at the top right. Then we're gonna, for restrict bounds, that's a Boolean, we're gonna say false. And then the ID is going to be start ID, which we haven't actually declared yet, so don't worry about that yet. And then you want to, after declaring each parameter, clear the struct to make sure you're starting again with a clean parameter. And let's work on the second one. It's going to be an end. We'll call this end ID. And then we want to set the X and Y default to 100 and 100. Actually, let's go 75, 75 and start at 25, 25. And then we have a color and we can use that to choose the color of our line. Now we need to declare these IDs here. You can do that under headers, skeleton.h. These are the IDs that it's referring to. So we had a start ID and that this first one should be equal to 1 because it's a numeration. And then we had the end ID, which will be equal to 2. Then we deleted this parameter, the gain disk, and I'm just going to simplify this to color ID because we're going to keep that. We also have another enumeration up here. We want to make the same changes. In this enumeration, the input is the very first one at 0, and then we have the start, and it just prefixed with the name of the plugin, so I'm going to call it skeleton start, skeleton end, and then we've got skeleton color. And at the moment, this enumeration actually lines up with the second enumeration. You might be wondering, why do we have two enumerations? That's because this one is allowed, the order of it is allowed to change, but this one, it's not allowed to change. Eventually, they might not match up. When we declare parameters, we use the IDs here. If we go into param setup, I just need to change this one to color ID because I changed it. And then we want to, in the render function, access the parameters. We will refer to it by the skeleton prefix. And we access these through the params array. X is going to be params, and that's an array, so then we identify which element we want, and that would be skeleton start. And then we point that to U, and then which kind of parameter this is. A point def, which is what we have, is referred to as .td, I don't know why. And then we want the X value of that. And I think for legacy reasons, this value is actually a fixed value. We need to convert that to an integer. So we can use the macro fix to float, which will just, I believe, divide it by 65,000 or something. We can check what that does. Yeah, 65,536. And that will give us the value that we want. Even though this is going to return a float value, we are sampling whole values. So that's why we're referring to it as an integer. That's x, y will refer to the same, but the y value. Then x1 will refer to the skeleton end x value. Y will be similar, but refer to the y value. And let's just neaten this up a bit. Got the start and the end values, x and y, x and y. Let's also pass this a color. We want a pf pixel, and we'll call this color, and then let's access it from the params, skeleton color, and then we want ucd, which is color def, which kind of makes more sense, dot value. And then we can pass that to our draw line function, pass it in after the output, and this will be a pf pixel called color. And then what we want to do is say, instead of defining this hard-coded red value here, we can say my pixel equals color, but this is a pointer, so we want to say what pointer is pointing to should be equal to the value of the color that we pass in. Now we just want to make sure that the color that we got has an alpha value, because the color picker I don't think has an alpha value, so we're going to just set that to 255 here before we pass it in, and then that way we don't have to worry about the alpha because we know it's going to be 255. Now let's just make sure that we copy the same. I like to rebuild if I change the parameters at all, just so that it can refresh any of the resources that it has. Otherwise you might have trouble. And we got a warning which was treated as an error. So let's just turn off warnings treated as errors under C, C++. That by default is set to yes, but I don't care about warnings. Just go build, rebuild, and then let's launch the debugger. Create another solid and add skeleton. And there we have it. We have our start and our end. And the reason that that is here and there is because it starts at 25% in and ends at 75% in, what we set in our parameter defaults. You could move these around and even keyframe those. And we also have a color, which we can change, which is nice. Let's just play with our algorithm. We can see there's a problem. Some cases it doesn't really work. I guess the algorithm isn't very robust. That might need to be improved. We just got an exception. We tried to access a pixel that actually doesn't exist. Fix that by checking that we don't sample any pixels outside of the buffer. Let's write a function that takes in the x and y coordinate and the output buffer and will tell us whether the coordinates that we passed it are actually in or out. We'll return a boolean value and we'll call this isInside. X coordinate, the y coordinate, and then the output buffer, or the buffer, whichever buffer we pass to it, and we're going to refer to it as the output. And then we'll have a boolean value isInside, and we're going to say it's not inside by default, just to be safe, and we need to spell this correctly. And then if a certain condition is met, then isInside is going to evaluate to true, and then we will return isInside. The condition will have to be that x has to be greater than 0, because if we passed it a coordinate that was, say, negative, then it would be out of the bounds. So x has to be greater than 0, y has to be greater than 0, x has to be less than the buffer's width, and y has to be less than the buffer's height. Because if for the x coordinate was greater than the width, it would obviously be out of bounds. Same with the height. If all these conditions are met, then the coordinates that have passed are inside the bounds, and therefore we will return true. Otherwise, we will return false. Now what we can do is say if is inside, which is going to run that function, and we need to pass it the coordinates x, y, output. Only if that's true will we color the pixel. Let's copy that again, make sure it's the same here, and let's run it again. And now let's draw it out of bounds, and we can see that the plugin does not crash, thankfully, although it still plays up. You might have also noticed that this line is quite ugly, and that would be a very keen observation. That's because this line does not have any anti-aliasing. If you wanted an algorithm that would create a nice smooth line, I recommend Xiaolin Wu's, I'm not sure if that's how you pronounce it, his algorithm, which draws a anti-aliased line. Another solution might be to use a third-party library like Cairo, which can draw anti-aliased lines, it can draw Bezier lines, or even OpenGL, but that might be a little bit overkill. This one is a little bit more code, but the result is much better than our very stair-step line, because you'll notice that we're only ever drawing full pixels. We're not drawing transparent pixels. The algorithm detects if it's either on or off. It's a Boolean state, and that's why it doesn't look so crash hot. But other algorithms can draw transparent pixels to create the illusion of a straight line. Thank you for watching, and make sure you check out plugineverything.com, where we have lots of cool After Effects plugins, and we even have some free ones.